High Bridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Jefferson's America, The President, The Purchase, and The Explorers Who Transformed a Nation by Julie M. Fenster. Read by John Pruden. Introduction. John James Audubon, the ornithologist and painter, left his family at home in Ohio in October of 1820 and traveled in a slight state of desperation to New Orleans, a well-worn city newly vibrant and very rich. As he sat on a flatboat heading downriver, he gazed at the bird life on the water. When he couldn't do that, he liked to look at his billfold. It was stuffed, in lieu of money, with letters of recommendation from powerful people in the North. He fingered the letters, reread them, and even copied them one by one into his diary. At 36, Audubon may have been gripped by a compulsion to draw wild birds, but he was headed to New Orleans to make money painting humans, preferably free-spending ones. He chose a city that was chock-full of them. The fact that New Orleans' prosperity soared so steeply after 1803, when the city was acquired by the United States in the Louisiana Purchase, was anything but coincidence. The Spanish, who owned Louisiana up to 1801, had clamped down on the slave trade for long spans. They also enforced laws granting significant rights to those already living under slavery. Once the Americans were in charge, though, the law favored slave owners and the traders who shipped slaves in by the hundreds. If only in monetary terms, the price of labor dropped. New Orleans was soon clogged to the walls with cotton. Like an old bon vivant with money to burn, it was the latest favorite of a whole swarm of fortune seekers. Some worked even more quickly than others. A pickpocket made off with Audubon's billfold on the second day the artist was in town. Audubon had the grace to spare some pity for the thief, who had plucked a nice plump wallet only to end up with a bunch of letters. Those letters, however, had been Audubon's treasure. For days afterward, his spirits were very low, but they perked up when an acquaintance wrote a new letter of introduction, giving him entree to the resident he most wanted to meet, a naturalist who had once been very famous. As Audubon wrote in his diary, it was a letter to Dr. Hunter, whom I wished to see to procure the information I so much need about the Red River. Dr. George Hunter had actually seen only about 25 miles of the 1,300-mile Red River. In 1804, President Thomas Jefferson had arranged Hunter's role in the exploration of a section of the lower Mississippi's western tributaries, including a short run on the Red River. Afterward, he included Hunter's exploits in a special report to Congress. It was immediately published in book form, finding wide readership. In April of 1821, Audubon made his way to Hunter's Mills, the collection of small factories that Hunter owned, either outright or in partnerships. The fact that Hunter was rich suggested to Audubon that he might need a portrait. So it was that Audubon's assistant, a teenage friend of the family from Ohio, accompanied him to Hunter's Mills, lugging a portfolio of Audubon's artwork. "Low in funds," Audubon wrote, starting his description of the day. "Traveled as far as Dr. Hunter, the renowned man of Jefferson. We came on him rather unaware. The good man was pissing," Audubon continued. "We waited, and I gave him my letter." After that, the interview faltered. It came to a complete halt if Audubon asked Hunter to describe the Red River. Nor did the old adventurer want a portrait. "This physician may have been a great doctor formerly," Audubon wrote, "but now deprived of all that I call mind, I found it necessary to leave him to his mill's drudgery." Something stinging or just sad bound together the contrast that Audubon drew between the explorer that he anticipated and a vague 65-year-old making water in the yard. Yet for all of his disdain, tinged as it was with sarcasm, he gave Hunter a title that fit: the renowned man of Jefferson. When Hunter was exploring rivers for Jefferson in the newly acquired Louisiana Territory, leading an expedition with Mississippi's William Dunbar, he did his job gathering information on the terrain and the local residents. Even in the midst of the celebrated trip, Hunter might not have looked like a hero at first glance. if that was what a man of Jefferson was supposed to be. He shot himself by mistake. He designed a boat for the trip that didn't float, and he was so interested in money that Jefferson secretly warned Dunbar not to let him spend all his time looking for gold mines. Hunter earned his title Man of Jefferson not by doing everything right, but by going west when the president asked. He was one of eight people that Jefferson either hand-selected or oversaw as leaders of expeditions to explore the Louisiana Territory. The range in their ages reflected a search for leaders that was sometimes desperate and a spirit that was unsurprisingly rare. Meriwether Lewis, whom Jefferson had already sent to trace the Missouri River and a northwest route to the Pacific, was 29 when he left. William Clark, Lewis's choice for a co-captain, was 33. Hunter was 50 when Jefferson called on him, a wholesale chemist with a busy family in Philadelphia. Dunbar, his comrade, was even older. Jefferson sought men whose curiosity overcame any sense of complacency. The desperate desire to look over the horizon didn't prevail with others whom Jefferson asked, and there were said to be many. Comfortable Easterners, expert in science or navigation, who turned down the chance to endure months of hard labor with dangers as sly as malaria and as sudden as the strike of a water moccasin. Jefferson had in mind a very special combination of characteristics when he chose his explorers. He succinctly described the ideal as a person who to courage, prudence, habits, and health adapted to the woods and some familiarity with the Indian character joins a perfect knowledge of botany, natural history, mineralogy, and astronomy. He then added gloomily that no such person existed in America. He'd looked. Making it especially difficult was the fact that American colleges had yet to offer courses in the pure sciences, such as geology, or in the social sciences, such as geography. Making it even more challenging, according to Secretary of War Henry Dearborn, was the money-maddened atmosphere of the United States circa 1803. Dearborn was assisting the president in seeking men for the expeditions. In the rare cases in which a person might be interested or even expert in science, Dearborn was told during the search, their study goes just so far as it may be subservient to this all-devouring passion of gain. Jefferson initially wanted only scientists or geographers, but he was forced to broaden his criteria after a growing list of refusals. Peter Custis, who ultimately made the trip to the Red River for Jefferson, was a medical student. Thomas Freeman, the leader of that expedition, was a surveyor. For all different reasons, they decided to go west for the president. For one dominant reason, he snapped them up when he could. The explorers were Jefferson's other army. Wherever he sent them, the American flag followed. Yet they could go on the march without naming an adversary, a critical point at a time when the United States was locked in hair-trigger tension with one European power in particular, the enemy that was innately and relentlessly hated by early Americans was Spain. For millions of Protestants, the cause was carried in the name proudly given by Spain's subjects to their monarch, His Catholic Majesty. Many Americans, especially in the New England states, were not only virulently anti-Catholic, but fixated on Spanish persecution of Protestants in South America a century before. They had no intention of allowing any such measures to take hold in their new country. Merchants in the Middle States resented Spanish control of the Mississippi, already a critical trade route. In what was then the western frontier of Kentucky and the Mississippi Territory, Americans lived close enough to the Spanish to distrust them on geographical grounds, bad neighbors continually bickering over a fence. The fact that the Jefferson administration is best known for the Louisiana Purchase of 1803 and not for the disastrous War of Louisiana, a war that was soberly expected but never occurred, is the result of a diplomatic attitude that reflected Jefferson personally. His emissaries, Robert Livingston and James Monroe, had taken the initiative overseas to negotiate the purchase from Louisiana's short-term owners, the French. It was Jefferson's job to wrest it from the Spanish, who had been there for generations. The Spanish in the region were perfectly right to be angry. After the purchase, the tension along the border between the two nations was real, mostly because no border existed. The French sold Louisiana and intentionally left the detail of drawing boundaries to the new owners. For that very reason, after the purchase, the president urgently focused on the exploration of the more southerly region now occupied by the states of Louisiana, Arkansas, and Oklahoma. To say that Jefferson responded to the new territory in a personal way would be an understatement. Louisiana is the president's favorite topic on all occasions, reported the British ambassador in 1804. He introduced it as usual when I made him a visit on his return to Washington from his estate in Virginia. The previous British ambassador, who had remained in Washington, was far less patient with Jefferson's effusiveness, informing the Home Office that the Louisiana purchase has elevated the president beyond imagination in his own opinion, calling Jefferson the vainest of men in relation to Louisiana. The ex-ambassador then accused him of hogging all of the credit for the transaction. Vain or not, Jefferson built his strategy for shaping the West on a truth. Right from the start and without having to think about it, the president made his name and Louisiana practically synonymous. If American voters noticed, it was politics. When foreign ambassadors noticed, it was diplomacy. His greatest problem, though, was giving that truth of his own making a strength that America didn't then possess. If Louisiana as a concept was too important for Jefferson to share, it was also too dangerous as an expanse to leave alone. Before anyone else, Jefferson entrusted the future of the American West to those varied men of Jefferson who explored it for him. 1. In play. Early in 1790, North America's two superpowers were arming themselves for all-out war, while their respective allies across Europe fell into line for what promised to be a stupendous carnage. Ships of the line were summoned to their home ports. Supplies were ordered and cannon made ready. Tens of thousands of men and more than a few women from Spain and Great Britain, Prussia, France, and Holland would die. But their lives wouldn't be lost for nothing. The coming war would decide once and for all which nation, Spain or Great Britain, held the right of entry into a village of 24 houses on a small island along the Pacific coast in what is now Western Canada. The village became known among the Europeans as Nootka. It was occupied by the Nuuka-Nulth Indians, who were amenable to visitors from either nation. The Nuuka-Nulth enjoyed a stable society, although there were persistent reports that they practiced cannibalism. Such accounts have been denied by their descendants. One explanation was that the Nuuka-Nulth thought it was the Europeans, indeed, who were the cannibals, and the Indians only offered a baked arm or leg, or worse, as a form of hospitality. More important in terms of international relations, the Nuuka-Nulth could supply otter pelts, newly valuable in European trade with China. The English claimed possession of Nootka because their explorer, Captain James Cook, had been the first European to visit there in 1778. The Spanish claimed it because their explorer, Vasco Núñez de Balboa, had been the first European in the Western Hemisphere to encounter the shores of the Pacific Ocean, albeit 4,000 miles to the south and 277 years before. According to a treaty current in 1513 among exploring nations, that moment accorded Spain legal right to all of the land along eastern Pacific waters, from the tip of South America to the top of North America, including Nootka. Because of the otter pelts, a rich theater of commerce was opened in Nootka in 1790, and both nations wanted to control it, but no one in diplomatic circles missed the more telling point. Britain was challenging Spain's claim to possess most of two continents on no firmer pretext than the fact that one of its sea captains had crashed out of a jungle one day in 1513 and stepped onto a beachfront in Panama. While the majority of wars throughout history have been regarded as the result of failed diplomacy, foreign ministers at the end of the 18th century had different expectations. In fact, the profession of the diplomat was turned upside down. Maneuvering into the best wars was the art form for chief diplomats of the era, notably Talleyrand in France, Godoy in Spain, and Grenville in Britain. With all that was at stake, The move toward all-out war between Spain and Britain escalated during the first part of 1790 until the European owner of Nootka, the little village with the odd-smelling fires, was perceived as nothing less than the tacit overlord of the entire Western Hemisphere. The British needed to find out how the Americans would ally themselves in the coming war, but they had no ambassador in the United States. 7 years after the end of the Revolutionary War, His Majesty's government still wouldn't stoop so low as to officially recognize its former colonists. Momentarily stumped, the British decided to send an alert, smooth-talking insider who was aware of the needs and nuances of British policy at the highest level, a diplomat in all but name. The man who was chosen, George Beckwith, was a military officer then serving as an aide to the governor of Canada. The only complication was that since he lacked diplomatic credentials, he couldn't hope to be received by the Secretary of State. From the British point of view, however, that was just an added benefit. At the time, the Secretary of State was Thomas Jefferson. His distrust of the British was such common knowledge that an Anglophilic U.S. congressman warned his colleagues that the Secretary of State cannot be confided in with information from London. Working in the nation's temporary capital of Philadelphia, Jefferson was no happier than that congressman with President Washington's choice of Secretary of State. He felt constrained at every turn, shut up in the four walls of an office, as he later put it, the sun ever excluded. For the first time in his life, Jefferson wasn't in charge. President Washington was. And he had co-workers who were on his level or straining to be just a little above it, notably Alexander Hamilton, the Secretary of the Treasury. Leadership at the State Department was a position well-suited to Jefferson's conviction that the primary function of federal government was foreign affairs. But in practice, he spent much of his time brooding over the outrages, real or perceived, perpetrated against him by Hamilton. Nonetheless, arriving at the State Department headquarters on High Street every morning, Jefferson duly presided over his staff of five employees, four clerks and a messenger. When Beckwith finally traveled to Philadelphia for high-level meetings on Nootka, he bypassed the State Department on High Street entirely and continued on to Walnut Street, where he conferred with Hamilton on the impending war. So it was that the Secretary of State with his four clerks plus a messenger sat inside those annoying walls of his office, keeping still and waiting for the Secretary of the Treasury to parry with America's greatest enemy, or ally. It is no wonder that Jefferson's frequent letters of resignation reflected his most impassioned writing in Philadelphia. Deliberate as usual, and a politician to the core, Jefferson stoically worked through his friend President Washington, who spoke for Hamilton, who spoke for Beckwith, who spoke for the British Foreign Office in the newly evolved mechanism of Anglo-American statecraft. Of particular interest to Jefferson was the fact that the future of his continent's western territories had, surprisingly enough, suddenly come into play in the Nootka affair. In the officially unofficial discussions with Hamilton, Beckwith disclosed that Britain was seriously considering seizing all of Spain's possessions in the New World. According to Beckwith, Britain would then free Spanish possessions in Central and South America as independent republics, but keep the North American tracts for itself. This would include Florida, which was divided into East and West sections then, and the Louisiana Territory, giving London control of the Mississippi River and New Orleans. Britain would also, incidentally, absorb Nootka. In leaking this possibility to Hamilton, Beckwith was testing whether the United States would object to Britain's goal or, perhaps, embrace it. Hamilton was initially receptive. Spain had alienated the United States with a recently enforced policy forbidding American commerce on the Mississippi River. Reversing Spain's policy concerning the river was one of Jefferson's top priorities at state, and the British promised that if they seized Louisiana, they would indeed lift the banishment of Americans on the Mississippi River. Surprisingly, though, Jefferson didn't welcome any switch in the West. Although the United States was an infant nation and an exhausted one in terms of war, Jefferson was determined to protect the Louisiana Territory, without even the remotest expectation of ownership. Jefferson prepared a long memo on the subject, arguing that Britain's presence in the American West would leave the United States completely encircled, both on land and through Britain's dominance on the sea. According to Jefferson's foreign policy, the West protected the United States more effectively than any army, but only in the hands of the right foreign government. In the memorandum, which he titled Considerations on Louisiana, he described Spain and England, each of which then controlled large expanses in North America, as two neighbors balancing each other. He tentatively accepted that status. In fact, he found comfort in it. Rejecting the prospect of a single power dominating all of America's borders, he feared that any war between England and Spain would prompt one to invade the North American possessions of the other, notably by bringing Britain into Louisiana, disrupting the balance of America's neighbors. Jefferson's conclusion was that Hamilton should tell Beckwith that the United States would view with extreme uneasiness any attempts of either power to seize the possessions of the other on our frontier. Hamilton conveyed as much in the next meeting with the British official, which Jefferson was actually allowed to attend. For the time being, Britain set aside the proposed conquest. The preparations for the Nootka War continued to sweep forward. And then in 1792, Spain unexpectedly approached Great Britain, suggesting that the two nations should not fight one another. On the contrary, they should coexist in Nootka. The reason given for avoiding war over the little village was that the two powers would be better off joining forces against France. The horrors of the French Revolution, especially in toppling the heads of aristocrats and royals, had changed the priorities in many monarchical governments at the time, though not enough to dissuade a strong nation, which Spain purported to be, from protecting its empire. Spain and Britain each sent emissaries to the Nucanuth's village to work out a permanent compromise. Their four-month negotiation was almost absurdly convivial, a battle of escalating hospitality. It was the last time either nation bothered with the place, and yet Nootka had changed the future of the North American West. In the Nootka affair, the United States voiced its first claim to influence European ambitions in North America. Jefferson's maneuverings were a demonstration of strength, a very early seed of what would become the Monroe Doctrine 33 years later. But the Spanish had a doctrine too, albeit an unwritten one, believing that they possessed by tradition or law or plain inevitability all of the territory south of the Canada border from the Pacific Ocean east to the Appalachians. The Spanish envisioned the eventual progression of their culture from Mexico and the Caribbean into the open spaces of the American West, that is, the Mexican North. In 1792, Jefferson's stance in the Nootka affair had given the United States something new, however, the presumption of influence over the region. It was a victory he wouldn't forget. Nootka also foretold more widely of Spanish defeat. The late monarch Carlos III had presided over a formidable empire. At his death in 1788, Spain was well situated, but his son and successor, Carlos IV, faced the first test of his reign with Nootka. He funked his chance. Even if the conclusion of the Nootka affair had all the elements of peace and reason, it was seen as a tremor of weakness on the part of Spain. Jefferson recognized it. So did Spain's own officials in North America, particularly those in the territorial capital of New Orleans and its satellites, Natchez and St. Louis. The Spanish crown may have blinked, but that only made the men on the job, the ones controlling Madrid's claims in North America, more adamant than ever. Natchez, 268 miles north of New Orleans by water, served a middle range of the Mississippi and the territory to the east. St. Louis, 1,180 miles farther north, administered what the Spanish knew of the upper Mississippi and lands to the west. Both answered to the Governor General of Louisiana, who was based in New Orleans. Starting in 1791, that influential post was filled by Francisco Luis Hector, Baron de Carondelet. At 44, he was a former military officer with far-reaching ambitions for New Orleans. Arriving 4 years after a fire had tragically but conveniently erased much of the old city, he worked enthusiastically to rebuild it as a fully modernized trade center, the economic powerhouse of the West. If Carondelet hadn't been under orders to allow Americans to operate businesses in the city proper, he wouldn't have had any use at all for them. His subordinates working in distant locales were more flexible, or at least more resigned. Zenon Trudeau, the amiable lieutenant governor based in tiny St. Louis, did little to discourage the stray Americans who made their way to his region, trusting that they would eventually be naturalized into loyal Spanish subjects. Manuel Galloso de Lemos, Natchez's lieutenant governor, also encouraged individual Americans in his district, even as he involved himself in serpentine schemes against the United States as a whole. But Carondelet was incorrigible, if not as a governor, then as a watchdog. He perceived the midsection of the continent in four sections, each of which existed to protect Mexico, Spain's treasure house, from American encroachment. First came Texas, then Louisiana, then the Mississippi River Valley, then Trans-Appalachia. If Carondelet had his way, all four would be scrubbed clean of Yankees. Carondelet had a problem, though, and so did his Catholic Majesty. The open secret was that Spain didn't have the money or the population to fulfill its territories. Its presence was especially lacking in the upper section of the Louisiana Territory, bisected by the Missouri River. According to statistics gathered by Lieutenant Governor Trudeau, the 400 million acres of upper Louisiana was home to just 2,665 Spanish subjects in 1795. Whites, free mulattoes, free Negroes, mulatto slaves, and Negro slaves. Nearly all of them lived along the Mississippi River, with a few dozen in the hamlet of St. Charles, 20 miles up the Missouri River. Carondelet was aware that he needed to populate the Louisiana Territory in order to protect it, but he was adamant that he wanted only Europeans, mainly Catholics, and specifically ones who could love and respect a monarch. He didn't want Americans, regarding them as ferocious men who know neither law nor subjection. He wasn't entirely wrong about that, since he was speaking specifically of the ones who were first into the Trans-Appalachian West. Many Americans along the East Coast would have agreed with him. The first Westerners were a rascally and often treacherous lot. But that changed quickly as the population of the Trans-Appalachian West grew into the hundreds of thousands in the 1790s. The migrants who struck out to the western edges of Trans-Appalachia were not looking for new rights, as were their ancestors. They were fleeing the country that offered more rights than any other on earth. A war had no sooner been fought for that cause than the exodus to the West began, bringing into question just what the cause had been. Only a few months after the peace treaty finalized the Revolutionary War, Washington himself was on his way west to Ohio looking for property. First in war, first in peace, and first in line at the Ohio Land Office, he bought his share of tracts, having once summed up the prevailing attitude in a letter. "Any person," he wrote, "who neglects the present opportunity of hunting out good lands and in some measure marking and distinguishing them for his own in order to keep others from settling them, will never regain it." Americans with political ties far less staunch than those of General Washington poured into Trans-Appalachia and straggled into regions of Spanish possession east and west of the Mississippi. Although Americans were forbidden by the Spanish from settling in Louisiana and from using the Mississippi River, except with permission, Lieutenant Governor Trudeau was more generous in his attitude and far more desperate to populate his region. He tried to convince Baron de Carondelet not to think of every instance of American immigration as a hostile incursion, but without success. Carondelet saw only the worst in the American character, or at least he had an accurate impression of just a small sampling of it. A little bit of corn, gunpowder, and balls suffices them. A house formed from the trunks of trees serves them as shelter. Their corn crop finished, they raise camp and then go further inland, always fleeing from any subordination and law. Teasing the Americans across the Mississippi was easy for the Spanish. Driving Jefferson and other American diplomats into fits of frustration must have come naturally, too, since they did it for years and could have gone on doing so in perpetuity. The basis of Spain's dominance was benign stagnation, a workable system over the course of generations. From one corner of the vast Louisiana Territory to another, the empire depended on the ability, gleaned from desperation, of local governors who played for time without population or wealth or military might. The Spanish finally met their match, though, in the form of a shaggy-faced hunter named Jacques de Glise. In October 1792, de Glise paddled down the lower Missouri River and trudged into St. Louis. With the information he delivered, a new front opened for the Spanish in America, and they saw clearly just how embarrassed their position had become. De Glise was a Spanish subject, despite his French name. He told Lieutenant Governor Trudeau that he had traveled 2,100 miles to the north and west on the Missouri River. At first, Trudeau seemed to classify de Glise with animal life, describing him as an ignorant man who made no observations and who hardly knows how to speak his own French language. Later, Trudeau allowed that de Glise probably did know how to speak his own language, but that he was from a province of France of such a peculiar dialect that nobody can understand it. Trudeau couldn't resist adding that he still thought de Glise was simple. He shouldn't have been quite so quick to make that judgment known. For the moment, the simpleton was smarter than anyone else in St. Louis. Traveling alone up the Missouri River, de Glise had been seeking undiscovered hunting grounds, or, even better, Indian nations that had yet to open trade with Europeans or Americans. What he found was astounding to him and all who heard about his journey later. In what is now central North Dakota, he came upon a highly active cluster of villages. They were at the center of, in Trudeau's words, a nation about which there was some knowledge under the name of Mandan, but to which no one had ever gone in this direction and by this river. The Mandan Indians and their neighbors, living in permanent domed houses behind the safety of stockade fences, seemed like Europeans to de Glise. They had lighter complexions than nearby tribes, such as the Sioux, and some had light-colored hair. De Glise estimated the population at 4,000 to 5,000. More recent estimates set a figure about half that size. But it was by far the biggest native settlement to the north or west of St. Louis, and in fact, it was at least twice as big as St. Louis itself. With large fields of corn, beans, peas, and oats, the people of the villages variously grew vegetables and hunted. They also traded with other tribes that were less productive, and apparently almost all of them were. Mandan commerce grew into a major operation, the economic powerhouse of the West, indeed. Colin G. Galloway has written that Assiniboines, Crees, Ojibways, Crows, Blackfeet, Flatheads, Nez Perces, Shoshones, Cheyennes, Arapahoes, Kiowas, Kiowa Apaches, Pawnees, Poncas, and various Sioux bands all visited the upper Missouri villages, either regularly or intermittently. Then the Europeans arrived. When de Glise walked into the Mandan villages in 1791, the first surprise was that he was welcomed. He might just as easily have been killed on sight, but the Mandans were accommodating to most visitors. De Glise then wasted his time by describing to the Mandans the advantages that would come to them from the commercial dealings he was about to establish with them. If anyone could judge commercial dealings, it was the Mandans. De Glise started to realize that fact when they showed him the array of goods they had for trade, starting with horses, the standard valuable of the Native American economy in the West. Even Indian slaves were available for sale. The Mandans and their neighbors could also offer English-manufactured goods of every type, including teapots and snuff boxes, but notably, they stocked a full line of guns and ammunition. De Glise was told that they had an active trade with the English, who had a settlement that was quite close, by the standards of the West, accessible in only 2 weeks. De Glise was particularly taken aback when he was shown leather goods from the Rio Grande area 2,000 miles to the south. "They have saddles and bridles in Mexican style for their horses," he marveled to Lieutenant Governor Trudeau. "They have furs of the finest sort and in abundance." Apparently, the Mandans were connected in trade with everyone on the better part of two continents, except for the Spanish in St. Louis. De Glise's report struck Lieutenant Governor Trudeau and other Spanish officials like a lightning bolt. The English, without an army or diplomacy, had brought their mercantilism deep into Spain's territory. Letters followed back and forth from St. Louis to New Orleans, and then on to either Madrid or San Ildefonso, Spain, where Charles IV's summer home was located. Before de Guise, the Spanish, who were administering the frontier, had come to the sensible conclusion that without money or soldiers or people in abundance, a territory can't be controlled. It can only be held, and rather gently. De Guise gave the Spanish, especially Trudeau, a fourth means of securing territory. Exploration could assert control because accurate information was another basis of power. Without delay, Trudeau launched a trading company to explore the Missouri River. Its earliest expeditions learned very quickly that de Guise had enjoyed a kind of beginner's luck. In his first voyage along the Missouri River, he had slipped past Indian nations that proved difficult or dangerous for later travelers. Despite the fact that de Guise didn't keep a journal, didn't collect samples, and probably never looked twice at an unusual flower unless he thought it might buy something from him, he moved among the Indians with more sensitivity than many of those who followed. Traders and travelers could easily disrupt trade and elicit trouble from one or another of the tribes, or cause trouble between whole nations. Joseph Guerreau, a trader who accompanied de Guise on his second journey, left an example of the damage that could be done by a crude interloper. He stopped at a Saanich village and never went any farther. De Guise continued on without him. Guerreau, having borrowed 1,600 pesos worth of merchandise on credit to use in trade for peltry, spent it instead for improper uses, according to de Guise. As one of his contemporaries explained, the nations along the Missouri vary widely in their attitudes toward carnal relations. Within several, though, it was reported that husbands, fathers, and brothers are importunate with the white men who visit them to make free with their wives, daughters, and sisters, particularly those who are most youthful and pretty, and in consideration thereof accept a few baubles or toys. Indeed, both the girls and married women are so easy and accessible that there are few of them whose favors cannot be bought with a little vermilion or blue ribbon. After about 18 months, Guerreau couldn't return to St. Louis because he had nothing to show for all the merchandise that he'd borrowed for his trip. During the same span, the Saanich village wouldn't take its pelts to the Spanish, since they were already receiving from Guerreau everything that Spain had to offer. Guerreau left a debacle in his wake, but he wasn't entirely unique in that respect. Misguided European Americans who looked on accommodating tribes as a vacation from their own culture strictures caused problems, yet they continued to arrive. As one disapproving explorer wrote, running at full speed like escaped horses in Venus's country. For explorers in the West, the attraction to hardship had to be stronger than anything, except for the resistance to ease in societies dramatically different from the one left behind. While further exploration of Upper Louisiana stalled in disarray, two men arrived separately in Philadelphia in 1792, hoping to follow the Missouri River west from St. Louis. Neither had any knowledge of the Mandan villages or of de Guise's trip to them, but one of the two, André Michaud, was an experienced investigator who caught the attention of Thomas Jefferson. Michaud had grown up on a farm in Versailles near the Royal Preserve outside Paris. Learning botany from local authorities, he was nothing if not driven, and despite his humble origins, he planned and completed a series of complex research trips. Gaining sponsors, he traveled farther and farther through Europe and Asia Minor, focusing on the study of trees. At age 39, his reputation was such that he was appointed by the French government to make botanical surveys in the Western Hemisphere. After completing a heroic trip to the shores of Hudson Bay, Michaud began to plan a trip west, as far as possible on the Missouri River. He had all of the requisites for exploration: field experience, knowledge of botany, and physical stamina. A vivid personality didn't hurt, certainly not in the very first step, because he needed someone to underwrite his trip to the west. Michaud soon found, however, that rich Americans were far less enthusiastic than their European counterparts in regard to both science and to spending money on science with no hope of a return. He eventually found his way to one of the exceptions, Thomas Jefferson. Jefferson wasn't in a position to express an official interest in exploration west of the Mississippi, It was foreign territory in unfriendly hands. Nonetheless, as Secretary of State, he placed a high priority on the Louisiana Territory. On meeting Michaud, he was intrigued both by the visitor's plan to find the source of the Missouri and, no doubt, by his background. With Jefferson's active assistance, Michaud received the endorsement of the American Philosophical Society and the promise of $5,000 on completion of a trip all the way to the Pacific Ocean. The APS, co-founded by Ben Franklin 50 years before, was a private club dedicated to spearheading intellectual thought. At that time, philosophical had a different meaning than it does today. It referred to rational knowledge, and especially in common use, to the pure sciences. At a time when U.S. colleges had yet to fully embrace chemistry, biology, astronomy, zoology, and anthropology, the APS encouraged those few Americans with an interest in such sciences. It was based in Philadelphia, where Jefferson took full advantage of his membership and enthusiastically attended APS meetings. The APS raised a small advance to help Michaud while continuing the promise of more once he had finished his journey west. The second hopeful to land in Philadelphia looking for the chance to chase the Missouri source had, in comparison to Michaud, no qualifications. In terms of field experience, he'd never traveled anywhere except in his native Wales, and then mostly along country lanes. Knowledge of natural science, he was a 22-year-old part-time clergyman. Stamina, untested, as was everything else about him. Even in Philadelphia, John Evans was a greenhorn, and Philadelphia was a long way from the wilds of the Missouri River. Evans had arrived in America all alone, on a mission that had nothing at all to do with scientific exploration. His quest was the legendary tribe of Welsh Indians. The Welsh Indians were said to be descended from a hero named Madoc, who was said to have traveled to America in the 12th century. The most compelling evidence of their existence came from a minister originally from Wales who claimed he'd been captured by Indians in North Carolina around 1740. Just as they were on the verge of burning him alive, he said some sort of farewell to himself in his native tongue. The Indians responded in Welsh, and after a happy reunion of sorts, the execution was canceled. The legend intrigued many people of a romantic nature in Britain, and so it was that one of them stepped forward with loud fanfare to search for the tribe. Fanfare is all that there was, however. When he bowed out at the last minute, John Evans impulsively took his place and set sail across the Atlantic. In Philadelphia, Evans was looking for sponsorship money at the same time as Michaud. But while Michaud was jotting a splendid entry in his journal, "Ma proposition ayant été acceptée, j'ai donné à Monsieur Jefferson, secrétaire d'État, les conditions auxquelles je suis disposé à entreprendre ce voyage." My proposition having been accepted, I gave Mr. Jefferson, the Secretary of State, the conditions under which I would undertake this journey. Evans was making a cold call on one of Philadelphia's many enclaves of Welsh immigrants. He did his best to make a patriotic argument for a stipend, but when he was finished, he was bluntly informed that they'd already sent someone to look for the Welsh Indians. Regardless of whether that was true or just a ready answer for a callow young man, Evans failed to win a single sponsor in Philadelphia. Quitting the city in March 1793, he made his way west anyway, without help. Michaud also left for the west early in 1793. By that time, Jefferson had begun to doubt him. Although he had written letters to raise funds for Michaud, he only gave $12.50 of his own money to the effort. Moreover, when a neighbor from Virginia, 18-year-old Meriwether Lewis, wrote to Jefferson and warmly solicited permission to accompany the Michaud expedition, he was flatly turned down. Indeed, Michaud never even made it as far as St. Louis. On his way to seek the Missouri's source and a route to the ocean beyond, he was sidetracked in Kentucky, where he was instrumental in a French plan to conquer Spanish Florida, and perhaps Louisiana. The trip to discover a water route to the Pacific would have to wait. A revolution was rising. The fact that Michaud had so many adventures from which to choose reflects just how unsettled Trans-Appalachia was during the 1790s. A robust person could barely stop there without being invited to conquer it. The French plot for the Floridas and Louisiana was being overseen by a diplomatic official, the plenipotentiary Edmond Genet. He was authorized by his superiors in France to raise an army which would attack Spanish possessions from a base in Kentucky. The head of Genet's military force, a man who was accorded the title Major General of the Independent and Revolutionary Legion of the Mississippi, was George Rogers Clark. Clark had once held a different title, Major General of the Kentucky Militia of the Continental Army of the United States. Storming British strongholds in Indiana and Illinois early in the Revolutionary War, he'd been a national hero just when the American side was starved for them. An acquaintance described him then. Colonel Clark was nature's favorite in his person as well as his mind. He was large and athletic, capable of enduring much, yet formed with such noble symmetry and manly beauty that he combined much grace and elegance together with great firmness of character. He was grave and dignified in his deportment, agreeable and affable with his soldiers when relaxed from duty, but in crisis, when the fate of a campaign was at stake or the lives of his brave warriors were in danger, he became stern and severe. His appearance in these perils indicated without language to these men that every soldier must do his duty. Clark spent his own money outfitting his militia, and he took a physical beating during his successful campaigns for the American cause. In 1793, though, 10 years after the war ended, he had yet to be repaid for his expenditures and was reduced to shuffling among his siblings for care. His older brother Jonathan, a Virginia legislator, continually pressed his case with the authorities there and in Philadelphia to no avail. George Clark's problem was summarized by historian James Fisher. On the basis of his success in 1778-1779, Clark had assumed that he was the pivotal personality in the West. During the war, he was just that. 15 years later, though, few others saw Clark the way he saw himself, which is a predicament for anyone when it becomes an obsession. The number of believers was, if anything, only dwindling. First among those who did look on Clark as the once and future pivotal personality in the West was his little brother William. For him and by him, George's heroism was kept buffed through all the years. William, also serving as an army officer, took responsibility for the organization of George's claims on the regional level. At the age of 41, though, George Rogers Clark had his own plan to recoup his losses, all of them. He was raring for a new conquest if only someone would call on him. Disavowing the United States in favor of the opportunity to return to glory, he had even tried to interest the Spanish in several ventures. Jefferson felt as tenderly toward George Rogers Clark as for the members of his own family. He had known Clark as a toddler, 9 years his junior. Their families both lived for a long time near Charlottesville, and they socialized frequently. In adulthood, Jefferson moved toward statesmanship and Clark toward the military from his new base in Kentucky, but they always remained loyal to each other. Jefferson, as Secretary of State, was aware of Clark's seditious forays with the Spanish, attributing them to disappointment grown morbid. He also knew that Clark had taken to drink. He wrote to a mutual friend, Harry Inez, a federal district court judge in Kentucky, saying of Clark, "I know the greatness of his mind and am the more mortified at the cause which obscures it. Had not this unhappily taken place, there was nothing he might not have hoped. Could it be surmounted, his lost ground might yet be recovered. No man alive rated him higher than I did, and would again were he to become again what I knew him." Unbeknownst to Jefferson, Judge Inez was even more involved with Spanish intrigues than was Clark. But then the same could have been said of a whole cadre of officials in Kentucky, including its U.S. Representative John Brown and, most notoriously, its military commander, General James Wilkinson. That was Kentucky in the 1790s, swarming with conspiracies. Even in 1792, when it was rushed into statehood, its future was still up for grabs. Spanish, French, American, independent, any status might have awaited Kentucky. Clark, attaching himself to Genet late in that year, was no great American patriot for his action, but he was trying with pathetic desperation to find his way in a state full of shadows. Genet's scheme was uncovered and it exploded in scandal. Clark was yet again disgraced and rumor spread that he would be arrested. He wasn't, but his problems continued. He wouldn't stop reaching, despite the fact that with every new attempt his reputation suffered yet another blow. William Clark watched his brother descend and continually tried to prop him up to the extent that a young man could. When the plot to found a new French empire in Kentucky disintegrated, Genet and Michaud both quietly left the state. The American Philosophical Society just as quietly marked the expedition to the Missouri River failed. Michaud retired to a tree nursery business that he owned in South Carolina. John Evans, the tortoise to Michaud's hare, was still moving west slowly, arriving in St. Louis before the end of 1793. While he was there, he enthusiastically repeated the story of the Welsh Indians and expressed his belief that they almost certainly must be living along the Missouri River. He had heard of the Paducah Indians of the Northern Plains and thought the name sounded something like Madoc. The logic of his conclusion was tenuous enough, but sadly, even his supposition was faulty. There were no Paducah Indians. It was a name rather sloppily attached to any number of tribes, especially Plains Apaches and later to Comanches. It could also be given erroneously to any party of Indians that was otherwise hard to identify. When Lieutenant Governor Trudeau heard about the Welsh Indians, he issued an arrest warrant for John Evans. It never occurred to Trudeau that a person could actually believe in anything as preposterous as Welsh Indians. He considered Evans's story an overly imaginative British plot to place a spy along the Missouri River. That being a military offense, there was no trial and no sentence. Evans was simply locked in a cell in a jailhouse in St. Louis, entirely at the mercy of the lieutenant governor. The best hope for proceeding with the exploration of the West was shut up in four walls. Moreover, as 1794 began, the best hope for promoting it wasn't. 2. The Man in the Farming Coat. At the end of 1793, Thomas Jefferson left his post as Secretary of State, sending one last, truly final letter of resignation to President Washington, who sent back a reply thanking him kindly, expressing his understanding, and then asking him again if he wanted to stay a little longer. He didn't. Even after Jefferson arrived home at Monticello, he continued to be disturbed by his first-hand experience with American government as it grew into reality out of a stack of praiseworthy documents. His reversion to the farming life didn't take long, and by spring he was able to write a letter to President Washington that didn't make reference to Alexander Hamilton even once. It was just a docile message from one farmer to another discussing land use and crop rotation. First year wheat, Jefferson wrote. Second, corn, potatoes, peas. Third, rye or wheat, according to circumstances. Fourth and fifth, clover. If Jefferson felt unloved and ultimately exhausted over years away from home, the land at Monticello was in much the same shape. Jefferson described the condition of his fields as wretched, telling Washington, "Abandonment of them to the ravages of overseers has brought on them a degree of degradation far beyond what I had expected." During his first few months at home, Jefferson discussed his theories of crop rotation endlessly in letters and also in conversation. His neighbors tired of the very phrase. Jefferson was a contradictory character in most respects, but one facet was consistent in every light. Jefferson needed his land, that particular land in Monticello. He could have lived without his house had it burned down or needed to be rebuilt. He might even have enjoyed the chance to correct his mistakes, especially the ones that only he noticed. If, however, he had ever been forced to sell Monticello outright, there would have been nothing to replace it and nothing left under his feet. At the age of 24 in 1767, Jefferson had already inherited land holdings that totaled nearly 2,000 acres, but the Little Mountain and its surroundings, a tract of 683 acres, gave him the sense of home he'd never quite had before. As he wrote later, it was a hill 500 feet perpendicularly high. On the east side, it breaks down abruptly to the base. To the north, the property followed the Rivanna River. In the northwest, it overlooked the town of Charlottesville, 3 miles distant. Due west, the hilltop took in three valleys and the Blue Ridge Mountains, 25 miles away. To the south, it looked to the Ragged Mountains, which were just that, jutting up into points. Jefferson's mountain featured slopes and natural meadows, but the crown and great patches of the rest were covered in hardwood forests when he first started hiking there. The most obvious attraction was the view, which seemed to first-timers to be only of the surrounding lands and distant ranges. Jefferson never tired of those vistas, but he especially liked to look into the air above the land and, even more, to look down on the very sky to which others looked up. Writing to Mrs. Maria Causeway, an artist friend in Paris, he composed a rhetorical argument to tempt her into visiting America. He knew she would never make the trip, but to show her why he, likewise, couldn't remain in Europe, he described the place where he lived. Our own dear Monticello, where has nature spread so rich a mantle under the eye? Mountains, forest, rocks, rivers? With what majesty do we there ride above the storms? How sublime to look down into the workhouse of nature, to see her clouds, hail, snow, rain, thunder, all fabricated at our feet, and the glorious sun, when rising as if out of a distant water, just gilding the tops of the mountains and giving life to all nature. Jefferson thought in the long term about Monticello, continually experimenting with ways to take care of his tracts there and elsewhere. That idea contradicted the commonplace attitude in an era when land was expected to take care of Americans. Farmers used a tract for a few years and then found more land somewhere else, or let fields lie fallow for 5 or 10 years. Without those farming techniques, there wouldn't have been quite so many people rushing west past the Appalachians. Unlike other farmers in the late 1700s, Jefferson had no intention of letting his fields dry up, blow away, or wash out. For the first time in a long time, though, books offered no answers for him. He couldn't ask anyone either. If he wanted to know his land, he had to walk it, look at it, give it time, look at it again, and try to know what it was communicating. Before long, he knew the name of every tree and just which one was dead or missing, as Edmund Bacon, manager of the estate, recalled. Monticello is best known for the house which Jefferson designed. First, though, it was the land that designed him with the patience to be in something for the long term. Jefferson liked to inform his friends that he had returned to farming with an ardor which I scarcely knew in my youth. He explained to his friend President Washington that, instead of writing 10 or 12 letters a day, which I had been in the habit of doing as a thing in course, I put off answering my letters now, farmer-like, till a rainy day, and then find them sometimes postponed by other necessary occupations. He was happy to point out that, far from being locked inside the four walls of an office, he spent his days traveling from farm to farm and field to field on horseback. Jefferson described himself personally plowing fields and bringing in the hay, the hottest and dustiest job on a farm. At night, so he said, he was usually too tired from the outdoors and its exertions even to pick up a book. He boasted to his friends of wearing a farming coat with his riding overalls, the perfect picture of the rustic man. While Albemarle County was not as prickly as Philadelphia had been, neighboring farmers were openly skeptical of Jefferson's theories on agriculture, just as he was outright disdainful of theirs. Jefferson was an adamant proponent of the live fence, rarely seen in the United States, where his neighbors installed wooden fences around their fields to protect them from animals. Jefferson looked for a plant that would provide the same barrier. After considering a few possibilities, he planted a neat row of peach trees between his fields at Monticello. He seemed to be at his happiest planting trees, especially ones that would give him something to eat with heavy cream in midsummer. Peach trees were bushy enough for the purpose, and they grew quickly. In one sense, though, the timing of Jefferson's retreat was unfortunate. In 1795, 2 years after Jefferson left office, His successor as Secretary of State, Thomas Pinckney, presided over America's first diplomatic coup. He extracted from Spain the Treaty of San Lorenzo, a triumph that allowed, among other things, for free navigation of the Mississippi River by Americans. He also convinced the Spanish to recognize American sovereignty over Trans-Appalachia. The man in the farming coat had once been the guiding hand of those same negotiations, but Pinckney pressed the American case at the right moment when Spain was exhausted from its losing involvement in the French Revolution. The diplomatic victories, especially the one that opened the Mississippi, were celebrated like another 4th of July, with speeches and fireworks in town squares throughout the United States. Along the river from New Orleans to Natchez to St. Louis, Spanish residents were crestfallen. Many felt that their long-term efforts to control the Mississippi Valley had been annulled, according to the Spanish historian Miguel Gomez del Campillo. The vision fostered there by Carondelet and many others for a conservative and stable society in the Spanish vein would be thenceforth under pressure, if not outright attack. It was, in Carondelet's view, like trying to build a quaint village adjacent to a shantytown slum. Gayoso, the lieutenant governor of Natchez, had his own dilemma with the treaty. He was expected to surrender his seat in Natchez to the Yankees. All along the lower Mississippi River, the Spanish turned as slowly as possible to their new obligation under the Treaty of San Lorenzo to survey the 31st parallel, a line marked on modern maps by the northern edge of much of the Florida panhandle. Once that was done, there would be a border, and with a border, another nation would be leaning against Spanish America's doorstep. In the meantime, glumly awaiting the Americans, the Spanish along the lower Mississippi River continued to provide the government for Natchez and other sections of their stillborn empire to the east. Baron de Carondelet could hardly contain his disappointment over losing the chance to absorb it. In conformity with the treaty, he wrote to his superior in Madrid, "It is not in my power any longer to restrain the eruption of the people from the American states, who are approaching and are going to establish themselves on the eastern bank of the Mississippi. Your Excellency will see himself obliged to take beforehand the most active measures to oppose the introduction of those restless people who are a sort of determined bandits armed with rifles who frequently cross the Mississippi in numbers." He recognized a strain in the American character that did indeed reject government, whether American or Spanish. There were those for whom rights did not come from law or even from their creator, as described by Jefferson in the Declaration of Independence. Full and true independence was derived from just one thing, land. Seeking that sole connection where it was abundant, early Americans were drawing ever nearer to the disgust of Carondelet. Lieutenant Governor Trudeau in St. Louis was among the few Spanish officials who accepted the new treaty and even embraced it as an opportunity. He petitioned the government in New Orleans to emphasize Upper Louisiana in lieu of Trans-Appalachia by building a string of forts along the Missouri River. That would offer one form of resistance to invasion from the north, where the British loomed. The plan to build a network of forts didn't materialize. Only one was constructed. But Trudeau wasn't finished trying to scoop up the lost Spanish zeal for Trans-Appalachia. With the permission of Carondelet, Trudeau offered the award of 3,000 pesos to the first who should arrive at the South Sea. Since the time of Balboa, the Spanish used the term South Sea for nearly the entire Pacific Ocean. The North Sea was in the vicinity of Alaska. As part of the new impetus, the trading company that had been organized in the wake of Deglise's reports was revived and immediately sought men to carry out that forgotten aim, to follow the Missouri River to its source and then, by water or land, to the ocean beyond. At about the same time, Lieutenant Governor Trudeau took his own trip east across the Mississippi River to pay a visit to a colorful American judge named George Turner in Illinois. Over the course of their conversation, Trudeau mentioned John Evans, probably as an example of all that he had to forbear, spies disguised as Welshmen pretending to look for distant relatives in unexplored territory. Judge Turner had met Evans when the eager young traveler passed through Illinois, and he'd been impressed, recommending him so highly that Trudeau returned to St. Louis and set the Welshman free after 2 years' incarceration. Upon his release, Evans fairly burst back upon his main goal, cheerfully joining the Spanish voyage to find the source of the Missouri River. He was back on his way west again, and so were the Spanish. No expense was spared for the new expedition, which included 4 boats stuffed with goods to be used as presents for the Indian nations en route. The Omahas were to receive the first boatload, the Sioux the second, and the Mandans the third. The fourth was to be reserved for Indians in the Rocky Mountains. The flotilla was a veritable department store making its way upriver, and to say it was irresistible was also to say that it was doomed. The first major stop was the Omaha or Umaha settlement of Big Village on the west side of the Missouri, a few miles from the influx of the Sioux River. About 1,000 Omahas lived in Big Village under their charismatic yet absolutist chief Washingabase, known as Blackbird, who was said to live more luxuriously than any other person in North America. Europeans compared his lifestyle to that of an Arabian potentate. Blackbird had servants whose sole job it was to lightly massage his legs while he slept, using a specific technique that kept him from being awakened. When they weren't available, his military commanders vied for the chance to fill in. Blackbird had not inherited his chiefdom. He'd assumed it. A former medicine man, he generally maintained peace throughout the surrounding region, either because he could be a cunning diplomat or because he was an expert in the use of poison. On one occasion, he invited 60 other chiefs to a banquet, and then after dinner put a damper on the whole evening by announcing that the Great Spirit had just informed him that the guests would all be dead by morning. They were, but it couldn't have been a total surprise to Blackbird, since he was the one who put the arsenic in the food. Stories such as that indicated the reputation of Blackbird. His people loved him and his rivals feared him, and he instinctively knew how to meld the two emotions in others. He certainly understood the Europeans, even as they began to encroach on his river. As long as Blackbird was chief of the Omahas, the British and Spanish empires vied with everyone else to honor his undeniable power along the river he'd made his own. Blackbird duly received his allotted boatload of merchandise from the Spanish expedition, but when he heard about the other three, he wanted those too. Negotiations were protracted and tense. The Spanish gave him far more than his original share, even while they sought to gain his permission to establish a fort named for King Charles IV near Big Village. To finalize the deal, they attempted to bribe Blackbird with a solid silver medal. It proved to be a misstep. The medal was not merely symbolic, it was spiritual, or had that capacity in bringing other powers and energies into the new relationship between the Spanish and the Omaha. In addition, the manner in which it was proffered and then accepted was as important as the object itself to Blackbird, the lord of the Missouri River. Soon afterward, a Spanish boat was seen paddling as quickly as possible back to St. Louis to get another medal, of solid gold. For Indian nations in the Louisiana Territory's contended regions, the last quarter of the 18th century was a pinnacle, especially in relations with European Americans, because Indian allies were crucial in the administration of territory as well as in the development of trade. European nations competed to prove who could treat each nation or tribe with the most respect. The French were the most successful, the Spanish the most generous. The British varied, although they were the most innovative, creating, for example, biannual conclaves in towns such as Prairie du Chien, to which thousands of Indian leaders were invited, mostly for merriment. The most obvious method by which alliances were cultivated was through giving presents. That was the word used, and while the goods bestowed were indeed gifts in the usual sense of a thoughtfully selected item, they had other connotations as well. Acceptance of a present, especially a flag or a medal, indicated a certain understanding, even a contract. The goods were also given in lieu of fees for what amounted to business license on tribal lands. It would be wrong to consider presence in the late 18th century and on the northern plains as a paternalistic gesture on the part of the Europeans. They were in no position to be paternalistic because they were not the ones in control of the situation. By summer 1795, with the Spanish explorers mired down at Big Village, working to keep Blackbird on friendly terms and to avoid his dinner invitations, John Evans received orders to leave the main corps behind and continue northward. The expedition leader, a Scot named John Mackay, considered him a virtuous young man of promising talents, undaunted courage, and perseverance. Spanish officials in turn included Carondelet and Trudeau, recognized that Evans offered their best hope for a successful expedition to the west, and prepared instructions that were forwarded to him at the Spanish encampment, duly christened Fort Charles, near Big Village. One of the indications that the lower part of the Missouri was becoming more organized according to European sensibilities was the quantity of important letters that could be sent reliably along the route, in the care of independent traders. The orders and advisories given to Evans were remarkably similar to those that Jefferson wrote for Michaud, although the Spanish would not have been aware of the American document. The very first clause listed the extensive natural, astronomical, geographical, botanical, zoological, and general scientific data expected of Evans, along with specific facets of the sociology of every Indian nation to be encountered. The next clause, not surprisingly, advised what Evans would do when he ran out of ink. The directions continued with further suggestions, orders, and advice. According to the overall plan, Evans was to receive a load of goods from a Spanish trader who was thought to have stopped either in the Mandan villages or other Indian outposts along the way. In January 1796, Evans set out with about a half dozen men. The river, as he described it later, has its own way and rushed impetuously through mountains and hills. He was describing the badlands of what is now South Dakota. 2 months later, he reached the Mandan villages, where he found that members of a British trading company had recently constructed a fort on Spanish territory. What he didn't find, though, was any sign of the Spanish trader who was supposed to resupply him for the balance of his trip. In the meantime, Evans took the initiative to capture the fort for Spain. Only 25 years old, a civilian and practically alone, he removed the five traders inside, lowered the British flag, and raised the Spanish one. The fact that he was himself a British subject didn't stop him from acting on his conviction that Spain controlled all European interests in the region. Drifting loyalties were a part of life in the Louisiana Territory. When a good Briton or a Frenchman and sometimes an American arrived in the West, patriotism turned a fresh page, and sometimes a whole stack of them. Opportunism was the order of the day, as though one could choose where one was born, or at least for whom one would die. Across the Mississippi, a man such as Evans could tear down a flag that had once been his own simply because he had decided for himself that it didn't belong. That was a powerful reason, just in itself, to travel a half world away from the kings and the courts and the great diplomats of Europe. Several of the British traders were remarkably kind to Evans, as though they were abiding his rule as much out of pity as anything else. One of them, noticing that Evans had very little food, sent chocolate and sugar. Another, a well-known trader on the Canadian side named Big John McDonnell, sent a selection of English magazines. He also sent Evans a geography book.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.